We're going to start in Bit-Midbar, which is Pinchas, chapter 25, verse 7 through 13, is the sort of the the warm-up section that I want to talk about a little bit was in chapter 25. Last week, we ended up with verse 6 through 9. Yes, we'll do that. 6 through 9. And I want to sort of go back to last week's portion just briefly before we start Pentecost. Before we do, let's start with the blessing of the study of Torah. Who would like to say that prayer? Would anybody like to do that? Volunteer? Any volunteer? Yes, right here in the back. Say it loudly.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kitshanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah.
Amen. Very good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Your Hebrew is getting really good.
She's going to Hebrew class.
Are you going to Hebrew class? Good. Good. Okay, last week's class was the story of Balaam and Balak. Remember this, the four prophet, false prophet as we called him. But we actually really learned that he was a real prophet. He heard from God. He was a Gentile prophet. He was a prophet that spoke the word of God. He spoke with the authority of God. Yet he had a motivation that was not as pure as it should be. What was his motivation last week in the story? Money, right?
Money.
It was money. Yeah. He figured I could figure a way to go over there and still not curse Israel and get paid, right? Figured he could finagle around the whole thing. And we understand by the end of the story, he had ended up blessing them three times instead of cursing them, correct? And so at the end of the story, we have Balaam and Balak sort of, you see the king pretty upset that, I've brought you all the way here, paid you well, and you blessed them. What's the point? So he says, look, I have an idea that'll work. And we talked about how Israel cannot be cursed, that they can curse themselves, correct? The idea that people have floated around at time is the devil made me do it. We've heard this before, right? Well, we know the devil can't make you do something that you curse yourself by your behavior, by your actions, by your thought and your deed. And so what Balaam figured and realized that, well, I am not going to curse them. However, Israel, by their behavior, will automatically invoke the curse on them. Because, there is the blessing and the curse, right? So his idea was to get the Midianite women to sort of cavort with the Hebrew men. And it all started off almost like a... it was just familiar. They just became familiar. They were friends. They were good neighbors. They didn't live too far apart in the countryside. And so they started inviting the men to their parties. Now, we have to understand that the worship of Baal Peor is a worship of idolatry that is extremely sexual in its nature, right? So everything about sexuality, to include the most perverse sexuality, was a part of their worship. So for an individual, and I said this last week, for those who love God and love Torah, we understand that our worship is tied to Torah, correct? The study of Torah, the living out of Torah, the speaking of Torah, that is our worship. Well, for the idolatrous of Baal Peor in the Midianite clan, worship was their sexuality, was their sex, was their food, was their wine. It was an idolatry of indulgence. And so it had a little bit of, I guess a little appeal to it, right?
Flash.
It had a little flash, a little appeal to it. Welcome, come on in, Rich. Good to see you guys. It had a lot of appeal to it. Now think about it for a second. Any time that you engage the senses, the inclination, there's appeal. And then when you tell them that it's worship to God by doing these things, it's like, that's even better. It's like killing two birds with one stone. Mix a little of indulgence with religion, and we got a really nice combination. Well, it appears that the men were involved in some of the clans, not all, but some were involved in having these relationships, and they were enticed by the women. What the men didn't realize is that they were involved in pagan worship to Baal Peor. To them, they were just having a sexual relationship, right? So it's like the spouse that says, I know I cheated on you, but I was thinking about you the whole time.
Yeah.
Right?
Can that happen now, Rod, with other things?
Absolutely.
I mean, not sexual things. But
no, absolutely. Last week we talked about materialism, how materialism blinds the eyes of an individual who is attempting to obtain higher levels in relationship with God, right? Materialism sort of deafens the ears of an individual. And we also see that the inclination that a person has, if it is charged and if it is allowed to indulge itself, that will blind a person to what they're doing and what they're supposed to do. And at the same time, your inclination can blind you to such a place that you are convinced that you are doing something at a insignificant level, however you're violating the very Torah of Hashem. Does that make sense? So here these guys were thinking, I was just having sex. We're not worshiping Baal Peor, right? We're just having sex. But in the eyes of God, no, you are being an idolater and you are worshiping other gods. And we could actually probably think of several things within our own community in which people are engaged in indulgent behavior that is idolatrous. Yes, sir?
Yes, question. You know, all of these Hebrew men knew the Torah.
Absolutely.
So how could they go in and even have that kind of mindset, I wonder?
Well, first of all, it's not a vast majority of them, we know, but they affect a lot of people. Let me explain that. You would think that they understood Torah, but you remember at this, the 10 spies, the 12 spies, 10 of them, that spoke against Moshe and Aaron. When they spoke against Moshe and Aaron, God said, you spoke against me. So basically, they didn't believe God. They actually, the whole tale of this last three portions is really about those within the camp who didn't really believe Moshe heard from God. They are thinking, they've convinced themselves that Moshe's making all of this up. That he's sort of coming to all of these revelations and ideas himself. Now, you and I both know that that is usually the first line of defense for an indulgent person. Right? You understand what I'm saying? A person that recognizes that the scripture says this is what you should or should not do, what's one of the first things they say? Well, I'm not even sure if that's, you know, if, you know, God actually said that, or did Moses actually write that? We really don't know if he wrote that, right? So they sort of downplay this whole thing. Well, it appears that these individuals, though they knew the Torah, they had a problem with Moshe. We're going to examine this. Now let's get into the text. Watch in verse 10 of chapter 25. The Lord spoke with Moshe, saying, Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the priest, turned my anger from the Israelites by being zealous for my sake. And let's go back to 25. I want to go back to verse 2. I prefer to go back. I want to, just in case I don't want to leave anybody out. They called the people to sacrifice to their idols, and the people ate and worshipped their idols. They didn't eat the idols; they ate and worshipped the idols. I'm like, sure. And thus Israel became involved with Baal Peor, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel. And the Lord said to Moshe, "Lead all of the heads of the people and judge them." What does it mean, lead all the heads of the people? What translation do you have on Kumash? Do what?
Take all the leaders.
It's the ponchos.
Yeah, so what are they going to do to them? Say it again.
Hang them.
Taken. So is this a hanging? Or is it a decapitation? Or is this about bringing up the heads of the...
Take
leaders? Do we know?
It says hang them before Hashem.
There you go. So what we'll find is it's hanging them before Hashem. So basically they're going to have a public hanging. Now, I don't know that it's necessarily hanging by the neck like the old cowboy, get a rope. Okay, it could be hanging them, impaling them. We don't really know what it means, but it's hanging them. Because this is a very serious thing that's taking place. He said, lead all the heads of the people, judge them, kill the one who should be killed before the Lord in the clear face of the sun, so that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away from Israel. Moshe said to Israel's judges, each of you kill those of his men who attach themselves to Baal Peor. Now hold on a second. So each one of the judges have to themselves kill the people that they know directly have been involved in this behavior. The sages say that it was up to 158,000 people. It's a huge number. So this is no small thing. So at some level, these people not only were involved in the indulgent side, the worship side, or the sexual side. It didn't matter. It was all idolatry. Does that make sense? And he says, at that time an Israelite man came and brought a Midianite woman to his brethren in Moses' sight, and in the sight of the entire community of Israel, while they were weeping at the tent of meeting, Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the priest, saw and rose from the assembly and took a spear in his hand. And I will stop there for a second. Who is this guy? Do we know who the guy is?
A just man.
A just man. No, I'm talking about the guy that did the deed. The other guy. Zimri. He is Zimri, and he is from the tribe of Simeon, right? Simeon. Right?
Wasn't he a leader?
He was a leader. Yes, he was a leader.
He wasn't a priest.
He wasn't a priest, but he was a tribal leader, right? So let's catch this story for just a second. There's something going on. If you slow down and break the story down and sort of play it out in your head, this story is very, very interesting. The verse is just, two or three verses. It kind of skips on through and you really don't see this. Well, think about this for a second. There's a declaration that there are a number of individuals that are involved in this idolatrous practice. The anger of the Lord is shown. God speaks to Moshe and said, bring them out. Bring them out publicly in the face of the sun. Bring their darkness into the sun, right? Expose it to the light. And then when you expose it to the light, you're going to have the judges judge and kill those people that are involved. This is huge. At this point, Moshe and Eleazar are gobsmacked because they realize what's getting ready to happen. Pinchas is really gobsmacked because he's getting ready to see the judgment of God fall upon the camp again. Now, we just have come through Korah's rebellion. We've come through all of these different rebellions, and how can we have another one right on the cusp of entering into the land? And so at this time, Zimri shows up with the princess or one of the daughters of the king of the Midianites. And if you'll understand the custom and practice of Baal Peor, the king and his daughters and all of those people, they were like at the top of the pagan food chain, if that makes sense. And so the ultimate act of worship was for a man to offer his daughter to sexual deviant behavior. And the more deviant it was, the more, spiritual it was. I don't know. But she had given herself to this chief or this high, basically leader within the tribe. This woman was not just, she was not a girlfriend. Okay, she wasn't, what's some other slang words for?
Hooch.
Hoochie.
Well, that's not a girlfriend. That's not a girlfriend. You're saying that this was.
Yeah, this wasn't. Yeah. This is not. Wasn't a mistress. Wasn't a girlfriend. Now, in Zimri's mind, that's what it was. Okay. Okay. I'm going to follow you for a second. But the problem was, he was passing her around to everybody in his community. It was part of the practice. Now, this for a second amazes me. It says that he brought her before the what?
The
The tent of meeting, right in front of Moshe and Eliezer. That's bold. What do you think was going on?
Moses' wife was a Midianite.
Right. So wasn't Moses' wife a Midianite?
Yes.
Do you see something going on here? So here in the mind of a Zimri. Mm-hmm.
He has a Midianite. Why can't I?
He has a Midianite for a wife. Why can't I have her as a girlfriend? Right? Now, you and I both know that Moshe had a wife that was a righteous situation. Yeah. She was not a pagan in that sense. She followed Moshe, so in essence, converted. Here, this man has this Midianite hoochie mama that he wants to hook up with and wants to put it at the same level as Moshe's wife. Mm-hmm. Now do you see why there is this almost this shock and awe of the situation? Moshe standing there, Eliezer standing there thinking, I cannot believe what we're looking at, what this guy is doing. And then he takes her over in a fairly an alcove area to have this sexual act take place, this very deviant sexual act, where anybody could have walked past and seen it. Pinchas.
It says that their worship was publicly.
It was public. Absolutely.
Yeah, so worship. They did see it.
Yeah, it was.
So absolutely, no, absolutely, they didn't see it. This way, he wasn't like, you know, in his living room.
Right.
No.
With the fireplace and a glass of wine. Okay, he was like out by the tent of meeting someone close by.
Like Mardi Gras.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Like being in New Orleans,
yeah,
right?
Similar.
Right. So no, very, very similar. So this was going on. Pinchas comes over in his righteous anger.
Can we stop there for a second?
Yes.
Isn't it that nobody else made the move and Pinchas could not take it anymore because Moshe didn't do anything, Eleazar didn't do anything, so he's looking around and says, man, nobody's doing anything.
We got to do something.
I'm going to go in.
Right, so let me ask you, do you think Pinchas did this because they were having sex in public?
No.
Did he do this just because he was mad?
No.
No.
Okay, why do you think he did this?
Because they were offending God.
Yes. Okay, that's
Israel.
Number one. But what is the... Later on, we're going to see that Hashem gives him a covenant of wholeness
peace.
Or peace.
Yeah.
Okay, so why do you think that he did this? He saved the life of 160,000 Jews.
Sure did.
Israelites.
Because they were all going to die.
They're all going to die.
Yeah, exactly.
So the idea is this, is Pinchas was not just mad. Mm-hmm. It wasn't about the public sexual act, which I'm sure that was pretty offensive. But the idea of somebody didn't step forward and do something, a lot of people are going to die. Okay. Now you would think, how can a guy who just ran a spear through this couple while they lay on top of each other be considered by Hashem as a man who has a covenant of peace upon him and wholeness? Mm-hmm. How? Because by his act he restored the people. He brought restoration to the community. And you see, what this really should be all about, and we'll focus a little bit on more detailed in the next class, but the real story behind this is not Pinchas grabbing a spear and killing somebody. It was the fact that this man took the opportunity to be bold and courageous in the midst of everybody's shock and horror. It wasn't that Moshe and Eliezer were afraid to make a move or that they were hesitant. They were weeping.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why were the women at the tent of meeting weeping? Do you know why the people were weeping at the tent of the meeting? Do we know?
Because of
yes,
the,
well, I'll follow
happening.
You. Here we go. Let's read it. Yeah, verse 6, exactly. No, you're right on target. Here we go. At the time of the Israelite man came and brought a Midianite woman to his brethren in Moses' sight and in the sight of the entire community of Israelites, while they were weeping at the tent of meeting of entrance, who was weeping? It appears that Simeon's friends and family were all weeping. Why do you think they were weeping? Because they were going to die? Do you think they were repenting? This is really an interesting observation by by the sages who say that they were not at all there in repentance. They were there because they were getting ready to have their pleasure removed, and they were getting ready to see people be judged and die because of this, and they felt bad that this was going to happen in their community. This wasn't about repentance. They weren't like, I'm sorry for this. I mean, and that's why Zimri felt empowered to show up with this hookup. Does that make sense? Yes, ma'am.
Had the judges at this point already started going through the camp yes. killing?
And yes. Already started. Absolutely.
People were being killed.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But when I first read this, I thought it was because that they had saw the judgment and showed up and began to weep. But no, not at all. They were weeping because death was happening and they were losing this whole thing. They felt it was unfair. And why do you think about it a second, why do you think that Zimri shows up with her in arm in the face of Moshe? To say, what right do you have to kill these people who have had relationship with a Midianite woman when you yourself have had one? Now, do you see what's going on? It's like this real complex sort of emotional thing, but you and I both know you cannot cover your idolatry with some type of philosophical argument. Bottom line, it doesn't work. Either you're idolatrous or you're not idolatrous.
You know, isn't it amazing that just before this, Korah had the same incident.
Right.
Challenging
Moshe.
And here, there's another challenge.
Right.
Just right
exactly.
After it.
Right after the, right, exactly.
Even the guy that did the spearing.
Pinchas.
He didn't know what was going to happen to him. He just knew that what they were doing was wrong, and he needed to
absolutely.
Put an end to it.
So this, I was reminded, there's someone else whose husband is a police officer. I said this on the radio show today, that I've been when an officer had to kill somebody and knew and saw how decisive he acted at that moment, how clear thinking, how focused he was to kill that individual to save the life of several people. And I saw how weighty that was after that for that individual. And I see it. I saw that weightiness. Pinchas didn't just do this because he was an angry man. He did this because somebody had to stop the madness.
Right.
Somebody. We understand this concept, and this is one of the powerful concepts. You know, we've heard, especially from the stories of the Holocaust, that, you know, you save the life of one, you what?
Save the whole world.
You save the world, right? You save right. generations of people.
Right.
By this one action, he saved the whole community. I mean, you think about this. He saved the whole community. There is a powerful thing in the death of an individual brings atonement and redemption to a community. Yes, sir.
We have the same thing today. They just brought up about Clinton and Monica Lewinsky again.
Monica who?
Lewinsky.
Did you understand who I'm talking about?
Monica Lewinsky.
Okay, thank
yeah.
you.
Thank you very much.
So here it is video. Right here. Here's Moses again, you might say.
Right.
Okay, and then it goes on down here. You bring up a good point. You can be a hero to the people that don't get killed as a policeman.
Right.
Okay, but if you have one stray bullet that goes over here and kills an
innocent person, you can be...
Okay,
yeah.
And even if you kill the bad guys,
right.
you're going to have this libel suit.
Absolutely.
And it's just plain right here.
Right.
God protected Phinehas
right.
from the relatives of those that might want to avenge
right.
their
what,
death.
What do you think that they wanted to do?
They wanted to kill
they
him.
They wanted to kill him.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So... what stopped them? Let's continue. Oh, let's read on. Let's read on. This is good stuff. Let's see. By the way, Sandy's comment was yes, 24,000 had already died
right.
before they wow. begun. So, the Lord spoke to Moshe, saying, "Pinchas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the priest, turned my anger from the Israelites by being zealous for my name, for my sake among them. And I did not consume the Israelites in my jealousy. Therefore, tell him, behold, I decree for him my covenant of peace. It shall be for him and his children after him a covenant of everlasting priesthood, because he was zealous before his God." Who else has another translation or another phrase for zealous before his God?
He took vengeance
for his God. What else do you have?
Jealous
jealous for his God. Say again.
Impassioned
for his God. So once again, we are reminded that Pinchas did not do this out of any other reason besides he loved God with all of his heart, and he loved his people. He loved God's people. And so this fire, this zealousness to do what was right was important. And he says, the name of the killed Israelite man who killed the Midianite with the Midianite woman was Zimri, son of Salul, chief of a father's house of the household of Simeon. The name of the killed woman was a Midianite, and her name was Bill Cosby. No, I'm sorry. It was Cosby. You know, any woman by the name of Cosby, I'm just kind of wondering. The daughter of Zur, he was the head of peoples of the father's house, of a father's house in Midian. Let's stop there for a second. What is a covenant of peace? Well, first
nobody
of all,
nobody knows.
Nobody knows. Okay, so let's talk about this for a little bit. This is a good subject. Was Pinchas a priest?
No.
Was he a priest after this?
Yes.
Okay. Why was he a priest?
After Aaron's son.
Say again?
After Aaron's son.
After Aaron's son, correct. So after Aaron's son, he took the role of high priest, correct?
Right.
He's actually used to negotiate a very tense situation between those 2.5 tribes that didn't want to enter into the land. Do you remember? Well, we'll come to this in a few weeks. Right, Manasseh and
Ephraim.
They had too many sheep and cattle, and they preferred staying on the other side. And we'll see in the story that they actually used him to sort of negotiate a peace to find out exactly what was going on. As a matter of fact, the people recalled this story in this situation and said, "You're not going to, because the whole issue was is Ephraim, when they were going to build an altar before God when they, you know, pretty much." Develop their borders and where they were going to go. And the rumor had gotten back to Moshe that the Ephraimites, they're going to build an altar to a god, and this is pagan. We don't want to happen to us again what happened back with the time when Zimri did what he did. So they sent Pinchas there at the time, who was the priest, to find out what's going on. And of course, Pinchas finds out that no, they said, by no means would we do this. This is we only serve one God, and that our purpose is to honor and glorify him and give him thanks for what he's done for us. So it was all resolved. So Pinchas has given a covenant of peace. The better way to probably translate that, because peace, shalom, you know, we always say peace, and that's sort of a main word that we put in, but that actually shalom means several things, and maybe you guys can help me. What are some of the words associated with shalom?
There's
wholeness.
There's about 20 different deals to it.
Right? Wholeness, completion. I mean, they're just... They're, anything else? Any other words? What'd you say?
When you ask somebody, how are you? You say, how is your...
How is your peace?
How is your peace?
Yeah, that's exactly it. So you have wholeness. This really is more in line with that he had... He basically placed upon Pinchas this covenant of wholeness, meaning that you are a man that knows how to bring about shalom within the community and wholeness within the community. And we see this in his action later on. So he's known as a person of wholeness. So if God has a covenant of wholeness with Pinchas, that means that it says, Pinchas, you have been given sort of the great responsibility because you have shown yourself to be responsible to be a man of wholeness. So what was this about? This was about Pinchas bringing wholeness to Israel. It was about bringing redemption to Israel. It was about sort of a tikkun olam for Israel at the time. He took the personal responsibility to make sure that things were turned around. Yes, here and then here.
He had a short lineage, but during his lineage, it was total peace.
Absolutely.
But it was short. That's something I don't quite understand. But
yeah, don't either.
Could we say that for Israel as a whole, he rectified their soul?
Absolutely. He brought about rectification of the soul. This is really interesting because I think it was last week that we really talked, maybe it was before the class that we talked about soul, not what was the word for it?
Correction.
Soul correction, the whole idea of, you know, doing everything you can. Excuse me.
Sorry.
This goes on.
Video. I'm sorry.
The whole thing is the soul correction is a very important thing. That's what we're all doing in our life every day, right? Our mitzvah is about bringing soul correction. At the same time, we can help to facilitate soul correction for other people, right? And that's really important to understand. And Pinchas is this fine example. Now, that's pretty dramatic. Okay, and I don't think we're here promoting running spears through people. What we're here to promote is that when there needs to be a time for someone to stand up for justice, you stand up for justice. When you know there is time that you need to avert the judgment of people, you stand up before God and you bring honor to God instead of allowing something to continue on. It's very important. You had something you were going to say again?
No, Loretta kept talking.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Well, it gets so interesting here about his reward. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you looked at that.
Go ahead.
Well, it goes on to say that he's going to be made high priest. And then it goes on to say he's going to have an exceptionally long life.
Right.
Yes.
And then it goes on to say that he will live forever.
Right.
Now, how's that going to happen? And it goes on to say that he reappeared as Elijah.
Right. Yes. And
now,
they,
that's what somebody said.
Yeah, well, yeah. I've heard that. I've also heard that he was also Melchizedek. I've heard that. There's a lot of things out there. But the point is this. We all live forever.
Right.
Okay, we all live forever. Just news.
Our soul.
Our soul. Lives
forever. Do you not think it was because that is the, even though we don't know what the covenant of peace is, but it could be given to many, but that's what it contains?
That is what it contains, yes.
That's what I'm thinking.
Think about this.
That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Okay, now let's bring this back to soul correction just a second. Just soul correction. If one achieves soul correction in their life, then in essence, you have brought yourself to a place where in the world to come, there is completion. There's a covenant of completion in your life. That's the whole idea. The whole idea is an individual comes to this, is born and your soul placed within you, and you spend your entire life bringing about the formation of this soul, this great gift that Hashem puts within us. And for those who are capable of doing what it takes, at some level have brought about a covenant, have a covenant of peace or wholeness with God. And that's why it's so important as we live our lives that we guard ourselves, that we hold fast to the concepts of and precepts of Torah in our life, that we love God with our whole heart, we love individuals, we do acts of loving kindness, because in doing all of those things, we are at some level repairing our soul and also repairing our generation. And no, you know, rarely I would say, or probably never, would any of us be faced with a situation of having to take a life to save a life. But in reality, and here we're going to talk about something that Rabbi Nachman talks about, and that is that one never obtains the highest levels of closeness with Hashem until they nullify themselves. So the idea, truly, you have to run a spear through your yetzer achara, your evil inclination, right?
Is that through death? I mean, is that what he's saying?
No, what he's talking about is nullifying yourself by canceling out, by living by the righteous inclination or the yetzer tov, right? By living righteousness and goodness and peace and hope and all of these things by living out the positive spiritual side, you cause the evil inclination to become weakened and lessened in your life. And so, you know, it's not literally you're running a spear through your, because we're always stuck with these two inclinations, right? They're the things that give us free choice in our life. But at the same time, the more that you choose to do righteous, the easier it is to do mitzvah, right? The more mitzvah, you know, we know Pierre Cavot says the more mitzvah leads to mitzvah and transgression leads to transgression. So the idea is the more we do, the more, the easier it becomes. And the more correction we bring. Yes, ma'am.
And I think that as we read Torah and practice Torah, we identify these things within ourselves.
Correct.
And we stop it.
Mm-hmm.
Instead
right.
of being mad for 3 weeks, you're now right. mad for only 3 minutes.
3 days. Right. 3 days. Let's give it 3 days.
It does get better.
I mean, we don't want to get too religious here. 3 days is good. Three weeks.
3 days is good.
You had something in the back.
Getting back to what you're talking about the covenant of peace. Okay, I'm going to go on. I'm going to share a commentary.
Good. And make sure you speak loud so that people can hear on it.
Okay. So this is the book I have, a Chumash, and it's another perspective. It says, my pact of friendship, which literally means the covenant of peace.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And when it makes a side reference in number 6, God requires that the priest await a blessing of peace. Excuse me. God requires that the priest transmit blessings of peace. And in the Aaronic blessing, or the priestly blessing, the blessing from the Kohanim, it says, then grant you peace at the end of that three-part blessing. And that's in number 6, verse 22 to 26. Verse 22 to 26 in number 6. So that's in Vayasem Lecha Shalom. That's when you're granting peace and the idea of a covenant.
Right.
Peace, a covenant of peace.
Yeah. Berit Shalom, I think is what it's called in Hebrew. Is that right, Salai? Berit Shalom, the covenant of peace. Very
yeah,
good.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Berit
Shalom, yeah.
In Nachman, the Torah, it says, thus, Phinehas, he's got here, attained the covenant of peace, a covenant of eternal priesthood. And is that why they may say that he might be Melchizedek or something like that?
Yeah, that's sort of the gist of it. But, I mean, we really don't understand this. I mean, you look at Onkelos, you look at many of the...
They don't address Onkelos or
yeah.
Nobody in here didn't even touch it.
Mm-mm. We just really don't understand it.
But see, the thing is, he says covenant, eternal priesthood. The priesthood is what I'm...
But the priesthood is eternal.
Yeah, but who's going to be the priest? Think about John in the next time.
In the world to come.
Yeah.
The next time.
In the world to come, who's going to
be priest?
So this is the idea. Think about this for a second. Is the priesthood an eternal priesthood?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Was Pinchas a priest before this?
Yes.
Before the incident?
No.
Oh, no.
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 He was Aaron's son.
Grandson.
He was grandson.
Right.
He became
so what made, when God says, I give you this covenant of peace and it is a priesthood, eternal priesthood, hello, that's what the priesthood is. It's eternal. So this doesn't mean that his is different from Aaron's.
Right.
This priesthood is eternal. So the priesthood Aaron had was eternal. The priesthood Eliezer had was eternal. I mean, so all the priesthood was there was an eternal priesthood.
So he was therefore allowed to enter into the priesthood.
Correct.
It wasn't just a different priesthood, you're saying.
Correct, absolutely. So he went into the priesthood that Aaron was in. So it's not a big mystery.
He was a priest to do priestly
yes.
duties in the temple? Or
right. Yes.
There is a commentary on the Talmud that states that Pinchas was a priest for war.
That is an interesting, yeah.
And that there was another priest, high priest, that it was for duty temples,
you
and
know
Pinchas
what?
Was for...
You know what, I have to look into that and see, because I really didn't think about that, but you're right.
And then in Deuteronomy 21:3, it talks about... Well, it's a long text.
Okay, well, what's the reference?
Deuteronomy 20, first chapter.
Okay. The first chapter,
uh-huh.
Verse 20. What, is that what you said?
Verse 20, chapter 1 and 3.
Okay. We are, I think that we're about, I don't want to go any further because I want to be able to break the next part down after this. So, I want to break the next part down later. in the next class. So this concludes the Torah class for today. We go into question and answer, and everyone say shalom.
Shalom. Shalom.